Thinking Aloud. Conversations on the leading edge of knowledge and discovery with psychologist Jeffrey Mishlove.
Hello and welcome. I'm Jeffrey Mishlove. Today we're going to look at the early years of the remote viewing and ESP research program at SRI International, a military industrial think tank located in Menlo Park, California. With me is one of the founders of that program, Russell Targ. Russell is a dear friend, a longtime friend, a laser physicist, and is the author of many books and many scientific papers. Amongst his books are The Reality of ESP, Mind Reach, The Mind Race, Limitless Mind, The Heart of the Mind. Welcome, Russell.
Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure to be with you. In an earlier interview, as we're talking about your childhood and your interest as a student in ESP research, we talked about the fact that you had developed with David Hurt, when you were in California, an ESP teaching machine. And in a way, this teaching machine is sort of what led to the development of the program at SRI, isn't it?
That's right. In May of 1972, I was invited to a conference on speculative technology that NASA held, and I had the opportunity to show this four-choice ESP game to Wernher von Braun. I said, this is a way to improve your psychic abilities. It's something that astronauts could use to get in touch with the spacecraft. Mm-hmm. We found that people can improve their ESP abilities by using this ability.
Simple training with feedback.
Right. It allowed a person to learn what it feels like when they're using their psychic abilities. Mm-hmm. And it turned out that von Braun did excellently with this machine. He suggested to the administrator that they support the program that I was hoping to start at Stanford. Mm-hmm. And the administrator said, I think we can find money to do that. Mm-hmm. So that was the first money that was made available to the program at SRI. I had been visiting the CIA in April of that year with the help of marketing people from Sylvania, which is where I was working. Mm-hmm. And I talked to Kit Green at the CIA. So by May of that year, I had been talking to the CIA and NASA about starting a program, and Hal Puthoff, who was working at SRI, was also interested in starting a program. Mm-hmm. So I approached Hal with the idea, let's start a program. You're at SRI, I have some money. I could join SRI and we could start a little program. Mm-hmm. So Hal and I, together with Charles Anderson, the president of SRI, Edgar Mitchell, who was an astronaut who just came back from space,
who
joined us.
Done an ESP experiment on one of the
right.
Apollo missions.
So Edgar Mitchell joined us, and George Pesterz, who was the head of new products. So we sort of piled on to Charlie Anderson. Uh-huh. And said, we have money and we have support. If we behave ourselves, can we start a program at SRI?
Yeah.
And Anderson let us do that.
Mm-hmm.
So that was that was in maybe June of that year. After
he was taking a big risk because parapsychology in general has always been controversial, and there were skeptics, people who call themselves skeptics, they're really scoffers who could be very, very nasty.
Now, one of the things that this shows is that even though Hal and I had no credentials for doing ESP research, mm-hmm. I was very well known as a laser physicist. Hal, with a PhD from Stanford, wrote a book on quantum electronics. Mm-hmm. So we had already established our credentials as people who are able to do something technical.
Yeah.
So if a person is thinking of getting a career, creating a career in parapsychology, mm-hmm. I would encourage them to do some other thing first that your sponsors can recognize?
The opposite of what I did.
That's right. Well, I observed as a physics student at Queens College in Columbia is that there's basically no money for parapsychology, yeah. And I think that has not changed.
Right.
But if you're an expert in something else, you can attract money because people recognize mm-hmm. that you're actually able to do difficult things and get them done.
Otherwise, you need to be largely an entrepreneurial spirit, which I suppose would characterize my career more.
Well, you made a lot of contributions as well.
I did, but not. I never received funding from NASA. I never had a position at a major military industrial think tank or a major college or university. Because of the path I chose, those things were pretty much out of the question, especially, frankly, Russell, after you introduced me to the PK man. But that's another story.
So people often want to know, did I make a big sacrifice to go into parapsychology after being a laser pioneer?
Yeah.
And I said, not at all. I gave myself a 20% pay raise to go from Sylvania to SRI, because I explained to SRI, this is a much more difficult field mm-hmm. than laser work. We don't know what's going to happen, whether I'm going to destroy my career. I'm bringing in a little money, but who knows what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. What we didn't know is that it would be a $20 million, 20-year program. So we had a very successful opportunity to move mm-hmm. forward in the psychic arena, but in the beginning, Hal Puthoff and I did not know what was going to happen.
Well, you were fortunate in those early years to be able to work with some very talented individuals.
That's definitely true. Before we leave this little ESP game, I want to tell you that is still alive.
Mm-hmm.
50 years later, you can now have your own ESP teaching machine. It's an application for mm-hmm. your iPhone.
Yep.
So the four-choice ESP game is available. It's called ESP Trainer, and it's free from the App Store.
It's your gift to the world.
It's my gift.
Yeah.
It says a Buddhist would not charge for the Dharma.
Uh-huh. Well, I should say it's one of your many gifts, Russell, because I know you have given of yourself freely for decades.
I've done my best. It's been a very interesting opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Met a lot of people.
Indeed you did. You've met some extraordinary people along the way, and not just in the parapsychological arena, but in other social circumstances, and even your famous brother-in-law, Bobby Fischer, one of perhaps the greatest chess player who ever lived.
I think that's true.
Mm-hmm. But to go back to the situation at SRI here, you and Hal Puthoff have now established the program. The head of SRI has given it its blessing. You've gotten a grant from NASA to work on the ESP teaching machine. And then, I gather, as word spread that this project had been established, other talented people mm-hmm. came along.
Well, Hal was in touch with Ingo Swann, who's a New York artist mm-hmm. and had already done significant psychic things, out-of-body experiments with Eileen Garrett mm-hmm. and Carlos Osis. An out-of-body experiment would be one where you're not only describing what's going on at a distant location or distant building, mm-hmm. but you seem to be able to go there and wander around the halls, and we can talk about that later.
Okay.
So Ingo is with us, and Hal and I, in our physicist way, would ask Ingo, can you describe what's in the box, or what's in the envelope, or what's in the next room? And swiftly, Ingo became unhappy with that limitation. He said, you know, this remote viewing that I'm telling you about allows you to focus your attention anywhere on the planet. I can see anything in the universe, and what you're having me do is a trivialization of my ability. Mm-hmm. I'm going to go home and resume painting. And I said, well, what do you want to do? He said, why don't you have somebody hide in the Bay Area and I'll describe where they are. Mm-hmm. So Ingo is really the father of remote viewing as we did it for the next couple of decades.
Now I suppose it's worth mentioning that Hal Puthoff and Ingo Swann were both Scientologists. And I imagine that their Scientology training inclined them toward this sort of thing.
It's true Hal and Ingo were Scientologists, but I, of course, was not a Scientologist, and many, many other people who worked with us were not Scientologists. Mm-hmm. Scientology might be a permission-giving device, but it's not necessary.
Okay. Where did Ingo...
From my point of view, becoming a Scientologist is too high a price, is an unnecessarily high price to pay to develop psychic abilities.
Well, did Ingo or Hal discuss any of that at the time?
I was quite familiar with their protocol.
Yeah.
There's Hal was very forthcoming with what that was all about and what it required, and I was not having any. I said, let's just do what we're doing. Mm-hmm. Seems to be working fine.
Mm-hmm. Did Ingo acquire his remote viewing abilities as a result of that background?
I think Ingo was a lifetime genetic childhood psychic.
Yeah, okay.
I think probably most of these prodigious psychics were early showers.
Mm-hmm.
About that time, we were doing experiments for the CIA, mm-hmm. who were interested in our work. And Pat Price, who was another Scientologist, probably heard about our work on the grapevine and said, I've been doing that all my life as a police commissioner. Mm-hmm. I'd quiet my mind and describe where the crook was hiding, and we'd go and pick him up. And Price came to work with us,
mm-hmm.
and the CIA was very interested in this, and they said, you guys are wasting your time playing psychic hide-and-go-seek in the Bay Area. What we had been doing is the experiment that Ingo Swann described. Hal would usually go hide with another SRI mm-hmm. manager, because we always had oversight. In these experiments, Hal or I could never do an experiment without oversight from our watchdog committee.
Mm-hmm.
So they would randomly choose one of 60 locations that I knew nothing about and go hide there for a half an hour. And I would sit with Price initially, the police commissioner, and I would say, well, here we are, we're at SRI. Can you describe where Hal and Joe are located now? And Price would say, I see a boat dock or a swimming pool or a church or whatever it was.
Mm-hmm.
And then they would come back and we would all go and visit the place. And Price seemed to be doing that very well. One of our early trials with Price, all of these things are done in an electrically shielded room.
Mm-hmm. So no possibility of radio communication.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
So I would be sitting with Price, and Hal and our contract monitor from the CIA, Kit Green. Kit Green was the branch chief for the Life Science Division, a highly intelligent physician mm-hmm. and CIA agent. So Hal and Kit Green went to hide somewhere, and I'm sitting with Pat Price, and I said, well, they've gone to their target today. What are your impressions? And he said, you know, I really don't see anything. Nothing comes to view. And in my continuing guise of trying to be a helpful interviewer, I said, well, Hal's taking his little green car. Why don't you just follow the little car out of the parking lot and see where they're going?
Uh-huh.
And he said, oh, I can do that. They're heading south on Middlefield Road, and it looks like they've gone to a water purification plant. I can draw that.
Mm-hmm.
And he drew a square pool of water and a round pool of water, a little building, and said, it looks like a water purification plant, and I see two big water tanks.
Mm-hmm.
I said, that's a very interesting drawing.
Mm-hmm.
Half hour later, Hal and Kit came back, and they had gone to Rinconada Swimming Pool, which has a 100-foot diameter pool and a rectangular pool, 60 by 80, perfectly matching what Price drew, but there's no water tanks. And the story, my story was that Price described this place excellently and made up the water tanks from his memory and imagination.
Which often happens in remote viewing, actually.
And it turned out 10 years later, with the 100th anniversary of the city of Palo Alto, we all got a picture book. Rinconada used to be a water purification plant. It had the two water tanks that Price drew that were there 100 years ago, and they would have been the biggest thing in Palo Alto.
So unbeknownst to him, he was doing retrocognition.
He was looking
backwards in time.
That's right. He was looking 5 miles down Middlefield Road and 100 years into the past.
Uh-huh. Or at least the some kind of residue impression was still there from those towers that had been there in the past and had been, I presume, taken down long
That's
ago.
That's right. Yeah. So we did 9 trials like that with Pat Price, and each time he would try and describe where hell was hiding in blind matching, where an analyst would try and match up all 9 of Price's transcripts against the 9 traveling orders for where people were going to be. That is to say, they would stand at Rinconada Park and say, which of these 9 transcripts is the best match?
Right.
And in that activity, they got 7 out of 9 first place matches, which is to say, if Hal were kidnapped 9 days in a row, Pat Price would have found him the first place he looked in 7 out of the 9 times. And that's significant at odds of about 1 in 100,000. And it was really quite a remarkable result. In fact, when I presented that data at the parapsychology conference in 1975 in Santa Barbara, people thought we were lying because these results were enormously stronger than people ever saw in ESP experiments.
And at that time, people were doing mostly the forced choice kinds of experiments.
That's right. Guessing locations in a naturalistic setting like this, where your friend is hiding somewhere, is infinitely easier than card guessing. Because in card guessing, you've got the mental noise of your knowledge of the possible cards. Mm-hmm. It's a diamond, hearts, spade or club, and you've got those burned into your memory. So if I tell you I'm looking at a card, it's very hard to separate the diaphanous image brought to you by ESP and get rid of your lifelong memory of looking at playing cards.
Yeah. Now, I know your critics at that point in time began to pounce all over this research and try to tear it apart and find something wrong. And I think they looked at, for example, subtle cues that might have helped the judges in their matching process. And I believe they even found some things that later
they could
on...
find subtle cues, but when the person draws a map of Rinconada Park that essentially lays over the map that's in the city plan, that can't be your lucky day.
Right.
And the CIA were concerned as well. They said, well, Ingo and Pat are, first of all, they're Scientologists, and they're also lifelong psychics. Yeah. Can't you find an ordinary person who's not done this before? Can't you find a control person? And I chose my friend Hella Hammid, who is a distinguished Life magazine photographer, woman of the world, escaped from Germany during the war, lived in France, lived in England, cultivated, highly intelligent, had just moved to Los Angeles. She's a friend of the family for a decade, and she thought it would be very entertaining to have her new job being a psychic for the CIA.
But she was to be the control subject.
She would be the control.
Somebody you presumably you would expect to get no results from.
That's right. She promised us that she had never done anything psychic in her life. She'd been involved in films. She'd been a highly sought after professional photographer, but no ESP. And we showed her how to do this, and she was being paid. So the whole She just thought this was very amusing to be paid to do something like this that she had never done. She was open to it. She was a meditator.
Yeah.
So she didn't think that this was a crazy thing to do. She wasn't a skeptic, but she just never did anything like this.
Mm-hmm.
And I again was the interviewer. I don't drive, of course, so I'm always a stay-at-home person.
Yeah. You became very gifted as what we call the monitor.
That's right, the interviewer.
Mm-hmm.
So I was with Hella, and we would each day ask her to describe where Hal, or usually Hal and a contract monitor, were hiding.
Mm-hmm.
And we did 9 trials with her because the CIA wanted to know how would a control subject do compared with the great psychic policeman.
Yeah.
Hella did superior to the psychic policeman. In her trials, whereas Price did wonderfully well at odds of 1 in 100,000, Hella was significant at odds of 1 in 1,000,000.
It would lead one to think, I suppose, since she said she had no psychic ability, that there must be some sensory leakage going on somewhere.
Well, she wouldn't say that she had no psychic ability. She said she had never done anything like this before.
Uh-huh. Pretty close.
That she was a. Mm-hmm. If you ask her, do you think you're intuitive? She'd have probably said yes.
Well, now let me ask you this question, Russell. What was your expectation at the time? Did you think she would have a null result or a highly?
No, I expected her to do very well.
Uh-huh. Aha.
My, I'm betting my career that people have psychic abilities. That this is a real ability, and people can learn to do it. Because I have a previous decade with the ESP teaching machine, so I had long expectation that psychic ability is available. And I bet on that because I had had psychic abilities as a young person.
Mm-hmm.
So the CIA was very amazed that Hella did so well, and they subsequently sent us some other people to see how their agents would do, to observe our programs. And they sent us 2 agents, both of whom did excellently in this protocol.
Yeah, and you in effect, I don't want to say you trained them, but you introduced them to the protocol.
That's right. We had a woman mechanical engineer, PhD, from the CIA named Francine, who said, I've seen what you're doing now with my partner here. I want to sit in the room by myself. You guys go hide somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And she made a spectacularly accurate drawing of our randomly chosen target. We were sent to we're given traveling orders from the safe. The manager gives us traveling orders. We get in the car and it said, go to the merry-go-round in Rinconada Park.
Yeah.
And she drew a cupola with a six-sided thing on top of a building, looked just like the merry-go-round.
Mm-hmm. And so this might be an example of somebody who you didn't have ongoing interaction with. She was a CIA agent.
And so she showed up for a week and then left.
And so for all we know, people like that who had been through SRI or some of the other official remote viewing projects and went back to their agencies may have developed programs of their own that were sort of not visible to the parapsychology.
We know that they did do that.
Uh-huh.
In the end, after Pat Price left SRI, he went to work for the CIA, and he worked with the 2 agents who were sent to us. So CIA had their own little community of remote viewers.
So it's theoretically possible then that even though the SRI program shut down and the subsequent programs that are publicly known to people are no longer in operation, there may have been continuous programs of which we're not aware.
To this day.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's an interesting observation.
Now, Hal finally got a vacation coming, so he went to South America with some friends, and they were traveling through Colombia, and Pat Price each day was the designated remote viewer.
Mm-hmm.
I would sit in the shielded room with Price and say, here it's 12 o'clock in California, would be 2 o'clock in Colombia. What do you see? And each day Price would say something like, I see a volcano, or I see a marketplace, or a harbor, or a church, or something like that.
Yeah.
And we were getting no feedback. And we did 4 trials like that.
Mm-hmm.
And on day 5, for some reason that I still can't remember, Price didn't show up. But I'm in my little shielded room. This is a remote viewing with Russ Targ and Pat Price. It's 12 o'clock, but Price doesn't seem to be here. So in the spirit that the show must go on, I'll do it. So I closed my eyes and I said, it looks to me like they're at an airport. I see an airport on an island and the runway goes from the back to the front. There's ocean at the end of the runway, sand and grass on the left, and an airport building on the right. And I drew that. That was my first remote viewing.
A direct hit.
Turned out to be a direct hit.
Yeah.
And the extreme good news from this is not that I'm psychic, but that remote viewing is so easy that even a scientist can do it.
Well, we often think of scientists as being very obtuse, but I think in your case, the focus, you have such an intense focus on what you do, and on top of that, an extraordinary sense of confidence that this is doable. It's contagious, and people who work with you seem to pick that up.
I think that's right. That's what, to get back to Bob Rosenthal's experimenter effect, the experimenter gets what he wants from his experiment. He, the experimenter, contrives the experiment so that it works.
And you seem to have, let's face it, Russell, you're probably one of the top 2 or 3 most successful experimenters in the history of parapsychology.
I've had a lot of talented people to work with.
Yeah.
In our next group were people from the U.S. Army.
Well, you know what, though? We're out of time right now. So I'll tell you what, we'll pursue that in yet another interview.
We'll stand by for the Army.
Because, you know, this is a rare opportunity to have you in the studio and to review this very important history with you. So I'm happy to do it in as much detail and depth as we can manage.
All right.
Russell, thank you so much for
being
with me, and thank you for being with us.